sind Psychiatry und Psychotherapy. In order to give the clinician, the physicians or, and the psychiatrists quick information whether there's some hint for autism spectrum disorder or not. And what a screening or every diagnostic instrument should be, it should be accurate, but also if we routinely use it in such a circumstance, it should be also easy to comprehend, especially for the parents who will answer these screening instruments, and it should also be very easy to use in daily practice. That means also dealing with missing data. These will play a role later in my talk. And it should be also economic regarding the time of answering and the calculation and interpretation of results. Okay, just to give you a quick reminder what some concepts I will use. As you certainly know, a diagnostic test that gets a positive result should detect the presence of the disorder or the illness or the diagnosis. This is called a hit. The rate of hits is called sensitivity. We have the correct rejections. The people that have this diagnosis not applied should have negative results. These are the two good cells in this table, and the bad cells are the false decisions, like false negative rate and the false positive rate. Here are the corresponding concepts in terms of probability, but I will not use them in the rest of my talk. Okay, let's begin with the social communication questionnaire. It was by Rutter, Bailey and Lord, 2003. Former version was known as the Autism Screening Questionnaire, and the German version, as I already said, is the Fragebogen zur sozialen Kommunikation, published in 2006. This screening instrument is, suitable for autism spectrum disorders and corresponds or follows the DSM-4 and ICD-10 diagnostic criteria for autism spectrum disorders, like the trias, social interactions or impairments in social interactions, impairments in communications, and and repetitive behaviors and stereotypes. And I give you here one example for each of these categories. Item 9 for impairments in social interaction: is his or her facial expression usually adequate, yes or no? For communication, item 21, at the age of 4 to 5, did he, she spontaneously imitate your behavior or those of others? Yes, no. For repetitive behaviors, one example would be, did he, she have special interests that other people find odd? Okay, the parent questionnaire consists of 40 yes or no items. Item 1 also has the purpose to determine whether the patient is verbal or nonverbal. So the remaining 39 questions will be summed up to a total score with cutoff points. The range is from 0 to 39 for the verbal patients and 0 for 33 for the nonverbal patients, leaving out the questions that deal with language. Items 1 to 19 ask for behaviors ever shown, and items 20 to 40 ask for behaviors between age 4 and 5. And the cutoff point is 15, as the authors have published. 15 and above is an indication for autism spectrum disorders, and then value above 16 would be indicative for autism. Application of this screening instrument is for children over 4 years with a mental age over 2 years, and the duration of application is less than 15 minutes. And according to the authors of the test, no interpretation should be made if the number of missing values is greater than 4. Okay. This is the reported sensitivity and specificity values of the original questionnaire. And I only want to emphasize this row here that specifies the sensitivity of differentiating autism spectrum disorders from other diagnoses, and Berument et al. Report a sensitivity value of 85% and a specificity value, meaning correct the number of correct rejections, to be 75%. For the German version, the figures are similar. We also have here the cutoff value of 50 or greater, and the Bölte and Puska report sensitivity value of 89%, meaning that 89% of the autistic patients were correctly detected and 91% were correctly rejected as having no diagnosis of autism or related disorders. Then some data or some information to the Marburg rating scale for Asperger's syndrome, the MBAS. A previous version had 65 questions, now the new version has 57, 70 more than the FSK. The screening is suitable for the detection of high-functioning autism spectrum disorders, and it also follows the ICD-10 and the DSM-4 criteria. It also has a factorial structure as revealed by a principal component analysis, and it has four subscales. The subscale one is theory of mind, playing behavior and playing with others with 70 questions, joint attention, emotion, gestures with 13 questions, stereotypes and inadequate behavior with 12 questions, and scale four with prosody, special interest, motor behavior, 9 questions. And as you can see here, these are no yes, no questions. It has a rating scale ranging from 0 to 4 with the endpoints of never and always. So it is a little bit more maybe sensitive for coding these impairments, but also more demanding for the parents to answer this. Okay, total score with cutoff points range 0 to 204. We also have here a group of questions that is asking for behaviors ever shown, and a group of questions asking for the behavior between age 4 to 5. The cutoff point is 103 and more, and this would count as a first hint for an autism spectrum disorder. Application, 6 years or older, and no mental retardation. This is also a little difference to the former, to the SCQ, where we had 4 years, and they make no restrictions according to cognitive functioning. Duration of application, less than 20 minutes, and no interpretation should be made if the missing values are equal or greater than 3. Okay. Reported sensitivity and specificity. I think I will skip the old version and tell you only the sensitivity and specificity values of the new version. Sensitivity is 94% and specificity for 89%, and this was assessed with a sample of N equals 141 with 33 high functioning autists, 36 Asperger syndrome patients, and 72 non-autistic controls. With these mean age and mean IQs, and for the non-autistic controls, with these distribution of diagnosis. Okay, so let me go step back and refer to this architecture of diagnostic research, or how one should proceed to come to or to assess the diagnostic validity of a diagnostic instrument. And Sackett and Haynes distinguish these four phases. Phase one is, do test results in affected patients differ from those in normal individuals? This is all. This refers only to the search for factors, variables, testing procedures that could make a distinction between patients with ASD and non-patients. And it's not very relevant here. Phase two are patients that got the diagnosis with certain test results are more likely to have the target disorder, and this refers to the sensitivity and specificity values I already gave to you. I think the reported values of sensitivity and specificity would all count as phase two investigations, because already diagnosed patients were applied or were assessed by the screening instrument. I think no investigation was made for phase three, where one should test whether there's a distinction between patients with and without the target disorder among those in whom it is clinically sensible to suspect the disorder. That's what we have done in the last year. We gave these questionnaires all our patients, all our new patients that came to our department. Phase four, I will skip it for reasons of time. Okay, so these two phases will be or are relevant for what we have done. We had one phase two diagnostic investigation. We had a retrospective study where we had about 50 patients with Asperger's or autism answered or questioned for several variables. The exact sample description can be will be presented to you by Monica Piscaldi in her talk. And what we gained from this sample is from these 32 samples, we got valid FSCars and valid MBAS questionnaires of 21 patients with this age and this gender proportion, 80 males to 3 females, 4 low-functioning autists, 5 high-functioning autists, 11 Asperger syndrome patients, and one patient with atypical autism. So here is the results of this diagnostic phase two study, only giving you the values of for sensitivity. What we got for these 21 patients is this distribution. We have here the scores of the social communication questionnaire. Here is the scores for the MBAS, and these two lines separate the cutoff values. Values above here should exceed the cutoff value of the social communication questionnaire, and values above here exceed the cutoff point of the MBAS. And as you can see, sensitivity is not as good as the reported results. We have a sensitivity for the social communication questionnaire of 71%, 15 of 21, and a sensitivity for the MBAS of 66.7%, 50 out of 21 were correctly identified as having a diagnosis or as having with patients with autism spectrum disorder. So we were a little bit sorry about that these sensitivity values were a little bit lower than that was reported. So we made a closer look on these false negatives, and what we found out is that two of the youngest of the FSK false negatives belonged to the two youngest of these sample, and two had missing values, one, two, three, or five questions. And if these questions had been answered according to autism, they could have been above the cutoff point. So there are four out of these patients in this group that could have been have special characteristics, and maybe this could be remedied in a certain way if one had computed the total score in a slightly different way, or had taken into account the age of the patients. The MBAS There's also one false negative, one of the two youngest patients were not detected. Two had missing values of that could have resulted in a cutoff point more than 103, and one had a low functioning autism. And to be fair, the authors of this test said that patients that are screened with this instrument should have no mental retardation, but three of them were correctly classified. Okay, then the more interesting diagnostic phase 3 study sample. These were 511 patients, outpatients, from quarter 3 and 4 in 2006 and quarter 1 and 2 in 2007, so these are rather fresh data. We got from them 229 valid SCQs and MBAS score, MBAS questionnaires back. And in this sample, there were 28 with autism spectrum disorders, and 201 had other disorders. And as you can see here, here are the sensitivity and specificity results of, in the same manner as I showed you before, the sensitivity for SCQ is 60.7%, and specificity is 91% for the MBAS. The sensitivity is a little bit lower, specificity is higher. So analysis of the false negative shows that especially the young patients were not detected, again with the SCQ, no missing value problem. Analysis of MBAS false negatives revealed that additionally two of the seven youngest also were not detected. So both questionnaires seem to have some problems with young patients. Okay, and the false positives. In the case of the FSK, there were 80 false positives, and 9 of them had a diagnosis of F90.1, meaning ADHD with conduct disorders, and 9 other other diagnoses that were spread over the whole other ICD-10 numbers. And analysis of the MBAS false positives revealed that also here 5 with ADHD and conduct disorder were correctly were incorrectly classified as being suspected for autism spectrum disorders, and the other 5 had. Okay. Conclusions. No big difference between both screening questionnaires. According to the missing value criteria for the SCQ greater 4, for the MBAS greater 3, more SCQ questionnaires can be analyzed with the FSK in comparison to MBAS. The application of the MBAS and also for the SCQ seems to be problematic for young children, especially children for under 6 years. The SCQ says that one can apply it with 4 years and older. Therefore, we should think about alternatives to use in this age group. Both instruments are useful in the beginning of the diagnostic process of children and adolescents, and we will continue to use them both for the very next future. So increasing the sensitivity of both instruments a little bit. But also, both instruments also have the potential to be improved. I think the cutoffs are a little bit high, so one should think about decrease the cutoffs in order to decrease the number of false negatives, and a better treatment of the missing value should be used. We would suggest a mean substitution of missing values instead of not only counting them to the total score. And also we are thinking about using non-compensatory measures instead of the suggested total score, meaning we could use cutoff values for scales, for subscales, and that was already mentioned as a possibility for the MBAS questionnaire especially. like all questionnaires, that it's affected by the lack of comprehension, aggravation, dissimulation, or answers according to social desirability. But especially for the field of autism screening, we also have to deal with the problem that affected parents may be insensitive to autistic symptoms. Okay, I will skip this.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for your attention.